by any means necessary on Radio Sputnik in Washington, D.C. I'm your host, Sean Blackmon, here with Jackie Luqman. And as always, we are your guide for connecting the political, social, and economic movements shaping the world around us. And today we're talking about the Day of National Rebellion inside Cuba. And we're happy to be joined for this conversation today by Arnold August, a Montreal-based author of three books on U.S.-Cuba Latin America relations. He is an award-winning journalist, publishes in English, Spanish, and French on several continents, collaborates with Telesur, Cuban TV, and Press TV Iran, is a contributing editor for the Canada Files, and a member of the International Manifesto Group. Arnold, thanks so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here once again.
It's a pleasure to have you back with us, Arnold. And of course, on this day, July 26th, 1953, there were assaults on the Moncada and Cespedes barracks that became very important events in the development of the Cuban Revolution. And I think particularly at this point in Cuba's history, with everything that it's still going through, what it's been able to achieve and what it still struggles with, I feel like it's important to really have a look back on the significance of this day and why it's important for Cuba at this juncture.
Well, I think the first thing to take into account is what was the situation way back in July in order to see the significance of the move taken by Fidel Castro and his followers. After the March 1952 violent coup d'etat carried out by the Batista forces with the full support of the U.S., of course, the political forces in Cuba at the time were looking for a way out. And it was only Fidel Castro and the party with which he was active at that time, the known as the Orthodox Party, it's like a sort of a social democratic revolutionary party, they came to the conclusion that the only way forward was armed struggle and nothing less. This went to, against the grain of some of the other political parties in Cuba at the time. For example, the Communist Party of Cuba, it was known otherwise at that time, but that party was still following the path of elections as a possibility to unseat the Batista regime. So Fidel Castro thought of something different. What we need is armed struggle. Now, it was important to point out that Fidel Castro, one of the main features of his political thinking, that Gabriel Marquez pointed out that Fidel Castro is the epitome of anti-dogmatism. That is, while being able to completely follow, imbibe, take into account revolutionary thinking, whether it's Jose Marti from Cuba or Marx or Engels, with which he was somewhat familiar at that time. He was able to forge something new that would go against the mainstream political opposition content at that time, and that was armed struggle. Now, it was important to take into account, once a decision was made to attack the Moncada barracks, those forces who initially, to say the least, were very reluctant to follow the position of taking up arms, did in fact rally to the cause of Fidel Castro and the July 26th movement. So that made it the success of it heading into the attack. Now, the attack itself actually failed. There were several logistic problems. The basic goal, Sean, was for to capture the barracks and to take all of the weapons that were badly needed for the ongoing or beginning of the armed struggle in the eastern part of Cuba. Now, it failed for various logistic reasons or whatever. And the fact was that many of those people who took up arms against the Moncada were injured. Many were actually captured by the Batista forces and executed within the barracks, but their bodies were lately thrown over the front of the barracks to give the impression that they were executed in the course of the battle, which was not the case. They were executed. Others managed to escape, but later were captured. And amongst those who escaped but later captured was a man called Fidel Castro. Now, here's where it becomes very interesting to get at, you know, the significance of that Moncada gesture, that Fidel Castro was scheduled to go to trial as a result of his participation in the attack against Moncada. Now, he was in solitary confinement in jail at the time, in very, very difficult conditions. Yet he put together, he wrote painstakingly his own defense. Remember, he was a lawyer as well as a very active revolutionary political person. So he wrote his whole defense. Now, when the guards found out that he was writing this defense, they arrived in his cell and they tore up the whole thing. But Fidel Castro, I guess one could say this is one of his characteristics, he actually reconstructed the defense in his mind and learned it by heart. So by the time he went to the trial, he had it all in front of him, and he was able to complete it successfully. Now, that defense, known as History Will Absolve Me, was actually clandestinely printed by the other members of that movement in the East and even in the West in Havana, and thousands of copies of his defense, History Will Absolve Me, were distributed all across Cuba and became sort of the official clandestine political position of the July 26th movement, which was based on the need for armed struggle against a U.S.-backed Batista regime, as well as a full program, for example, doing away with large landholders, giving land to the landless, supporting the struggles of the working class in the cities, etc. And it became the program for which they fought. And the next step, of course, the important point was that while Fidel Castro was in jail, there was so much support for his activity, and those of his other comrades, such as Raul Castro, who also were in prison, they actually succeeded in forcing Batista to give amnesty to them. And they came out of prison. Of course, Batista probably had in mind some electoral advantages he may have by freeing these people who had become heroes in Cuba. And when they were freed, did they start organized seriously for another attempt. This one starting from Mexico, organizing to have a boat leaving Mexico with several hundred fighters, now called the July 26th Movement, to land in eastern Cuba in order to start the armed uprising that eventually will lead. They landed in this end of 1956. So within a couple of years, between November of that year, 1956, till January 1st, 1959, that is quite a short period of time, right? I mean, but they actually succeeded moving from their base in the rural areas in eastern Cuba, slowly moving westward to the other cities, to the countryside, and finally liberated the whole country. Just keep in mind, while they were fighting, the Batista forces, backed by the U.S., were using B-52 bombers, all kinds of military equipment against this very small ragtag guerrilla army. But because of the content of their manifesto, of the group that history will absolve me. That whole program won the backing of millions of Cubans all across the island, and the inevitable took place. The Batista regime folded and was no longer able to operate, and eventually just fled out of the country. And so January 1, 1959, Fidel Castro was able to declare in a public meeting in Santiago de Cuba that the revolution has been won. But he also said this was an important victory, but in the future, things are bound to be very difficult. And starting in January 1st in Santiago de Cuba, the July 26th movement moved westward, all the way westward, until they reached Havana on January 8th, thus sort of culminating that struggle that took place from the Sierra Maestra, the landing of the Granma. But I also would say, I agree with what the Cubans say, that the real beginning of the Cuban Revolution was not the was not the attack on the Moncada Barracks on July 26th, but the real important initial stage of that revolution was way back when a wealthy landowner, Manuel de Cespedes, he left his home and went to the bell, which normally is used to ring very loudly, calling the slaves to work on his plantation. But on that day, October 10th, historical, he rang the bell, yes, but he called on the slaves to join with him and others of Spanish origin, but well entrenched in Cuba, to work together in order to overthrow the Spanish colonial domination, and with it, the very serious economic inequalities and also the slave system. So the Cubans rightly say that was the beginning of the revolution. It was later defeated 1898 temporarily when the United States, in its typical way, Sean, I'm sure you'll agree, they took over as Cuba was about to defeat the Spanish in 1898. The United States was able to interfere, take over that struggle, co-opt that struggle, and rather than Cuba becoming the victor against Spain, it was the United States that became the victorious force and recolonized Cuba from that time on. And that lasted in one form or another till January 1st, 1959. That is why Fidel and the leadership say that the January 1st, 1959 revolution is a continuation of the 1868 revolution. And I think this is an accurate assessment of the evolution of the Cuban Revolution and the key aspect of the very daring Moncada attack on that garrison led by Fidel Castro and the July 26th movement.
Definitely. Well, we thank you so much, Arnold, for joining us today. We're going to leave it there and move to a break here on By Any Means Necessary on Radio Sputnik in Washington, D.C.